नीला प्रेम धन करुणा प्रचुर हेन प्रभु कोथा गेला आचार्य ठाकुर
Oh. सकल सहने happiness and also pain and distress. So we, those who stay back, we have to go through the pain of separation, and happiness is that he has entered into his eternal place. So he is eternally happy there, but we will be feeling the separation from him because we will not get his association in this world. And all of you know that Maharaj is very specially dear to His Divine Grace S.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Although he joined a little late as compared to his godbrothers, he joined the movement in the year 1976. And he accepted Srila Prabhupada as a spiritual master by reading his book, Nectar of Devotion. And he went and joined Mayapur and waiting for Prabhupada to come to India. Then Prabhupada came to Kumbh Mela in Prayagraj. So devotees from Mayapur, they came to Kumbh Mela to meet Srila Prabhupada. So Bhakti Charaswami Maharaj also came in that bus. But somehow other he could not meet Srila Prabhupada in Prayagraj. But Prabhupada was coming back, I think to Calcutta, by a train. So in that train, Srila Prabhupada senior was disciples were there, but Prabhupada, when he was traveling, somehow Bhavananda Maharaj was also there. So he took Bhakti Charaswami Maharaj also with him. And Bhakti Charu Maharaj was very reluctant to meet him because he tried to meet him, but he was not, sometimes not allowed, and sometimes he was not able to take his darshan. So he felt that I am unqualified to meet His Divine Grace. So he was very reluctant to meet him. But Bhavananda Maharaj forced him. He took, grabbed his hand and just pushed him in the first class compartment. Prabhupada was traveling. And Maharaj offered obeisances. And Prabhupada told him, please come and sit next to me. So that time Tamal Krishna Maharaj was there, Bhavananda Maharaj was there, Jayapataka Maharaj also there. So he was reluctant to sit next to Prabhupada, but Prabhupada told him, no, sit down here. So at the first meeting, Prabhupada told directly, so I want you to translate my books into Bengali. So by that we can understand that their relationship is very deep and we should not take him as like other disciples. So their relationship is something is exceptional. And Maharaj was explaining how he was very reluctant to tell Prabhupada to give him initiation. So one day he thought that I'll ask him today. So he entered into Prabhupada's room and Prabhupada asked him, what do you want? So Bhakti Charu Maharaj said, Prabhupada, will you give me initiation? Because that time Prabhupada was little strict to give initiation also. Many devotees are waiting list. He said, yes, I'll give you initiation. Just Gaur Purnima is coming. In Gaur Purnima, I will give you initiation. So on Gaur Purnima, he got initiation, first initiation and second initiation together from His Divine Grace. And within 3 months, he was awarded the Sunyasa Order of Life. So I think he is the only person in only 3 months We cannot think this now in ISKCON. So in 3 months he was awarded. There were a lot of objection also. But Prabhupada understood the need, and he knew that he is the suitable candidate to carry on. So once I was discussing with Maharaj that what inspired you to dedicate like that. He said, once I was with Prabhupada at the roof of Lotus Building, and Prabhupada started telling him that enjoying senses is like the camels, they eat the blood while he takes the thorns. So he said, you have done that for many lifetimes, he was telling Prabhupada, he was telling Bhakti Charu Maharaj. At least give one life to Krishna and let's see what happens. So you have given so many lives for sense enjoyment, one life to Krishna, let's see what happens. He said, that is my inspiration to dedicate my life. And he gave me the same instruction, Maharaj, that same instruction applies to all the brahmacharis, those who want to dedicate completely for Krishna consciousness. So today he is not with us physically, but he'll be with us through his activities, instructions, remembrance, and that is the purpose of this program today. So we'll be hearing from senior devotees about Maharaj. So we'd like to hear about Bhakti Charu Maharaj from our Maharaj from Vrindavan. Thank you, Maharaj. Hare Krishna.
The disappearance happened recently of His Holiness Bhakti Charu Swami Maharaj. Actually, this year 2020, it is not good for the whole world. It's not suiting at all. Whole world is suffering in many ways, all sectors, economically, business wise, political, many ways suffering. But ISKCON people, they are chanting Hare Krishna, happy they are, but they got a big blow. Departure of Bhakti Charu Swami Maharaj is such a loss, I don't think we can fulfill it, we can fill up it again. Because Bhakti Charu Maharaj, already our Sankarsana Prabhu, he told, and everybody will know how Bhakti Charu Maharaj came in late in this moment, but very fast he got this super most opportunity as a personal servant to Prabhupada. It seems that the relation between Prabhupada and Bhakti Charu Maharaj was not in this birth. Many, many births, previous births, they had a relation. Many, many. By fast meeting, they could recognize each other. Oh, he is... It was said that Prabhupada, when he found out that he is a very cultured, highly educated, very perfect gentleman and from Calcutta. Prabhupada is a Calcutta boy, and he found out another Calcutta boy is well educated and very cultured, aristocratic family. He became really happy. And he was so humble and surrendered that Prabhupada became really overwhelmed, and he gave him the first assignment translating his books. First he said small books, and Prabhupada himself was proofreading his translation. Just imagine, Nowadays many translators' books, few will, they will do then correction, proofreading. But for Bhaktisar Maharaj translation, the proofreader was no other than His Divine Grace Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. So that makes more close, because he got opportunity, he has to check my translation, so nobody can stop him. He can go directly to meet Prabhupada to show his translation work. So, and Prabhupada figure out that he is a qualified person, he can do the job. And he told him that he should translate all my books into Bengali language. And Bhakti Charu Swami, he took that order so seriously. Whenever, actually daytime he was busy in serving, he used to translate in night time. Almost every day, he will get up in midnight and do his translation work. Until he finished all the books to translate into Bengali language. And then in 96, he offered to Prabhupada a series, Abhay Charan, a serial. And then he thought that, I don't have a center, I want to make a beautiful temple, offered to Prabhupada. And he took that project. And when he was searching where to do it, he came to Madhya Pradesh. He was such a mesmerizing personality. Anybody will come in contact with him, see him, he will be attracted. And at that time, the Chief Minister of Madhya Pradesh, he was so attracted and moved by his dealings that he personally traveled with Bhaktisar Swami to few places in a helicopter to show him few places in MP, and he was promising that if the Chief Minister, if he want to help, I want to give so many acres of land for this project, that project. Somehow or other, Maharaj selected Ujjain, though he have seen many few other places in Jabalpur site and the other sites selected, and they promised to give him few hundred acres of land. But somehow or other the government changed and things happened, it didn't work out. But still, as per the promise from his side, Bhaktisar Swami, he completed the whole temple, totally crystal white marble temple, three altar, guest house, restaurant, promissory house, everything, park, everything, within 8 to 10 months, not even a year, installation ceremony happened, temple opening. It's a wonder. Never ever so fast any temple opened. Such a beautiful, gorgeous temple. In 2012, in his Vyas Puja offering, he wrote to Prabhupada, Prabhupada, whatever assignment you had given to me, it's almost done. So I want to go back to you, please call me back. You have already called few of your child, so please call me back. And he was very much eager to go and serve Prabhupada, to join him where he is. He was not interested more here. It is in 2012, 8 years back. And after 8 years, His application got sanctioned and he went. In his pranam mantra, they used to say, Maharaji, Prabhupada gata prana, isn't it? This is fact. In most of the cases, we can see Bhaktichari Swami will consider Prabhupada more than Krishna. He says, Krishna, forget, I don't want to go to Golok Vrindavan, to Krishna Loka, I forget. I'm not interested in serving Krishna, much more interested in serving Prabhupada. So much so that he dedicated his Vyas Puja day, 17th September, that was his birthday, near about Radhashtami. But he didn't do according to Tithi, Janma Tithi. Everybody used to perform according to Tithi. He will not perform according to Tithi. Why? Because September 17th is a day, that day Prabhupada appeared in US, first time. So the appearance of Prabhupada in America, so he dedicated his birthday as a Prabhupada memorial day. Each year, in Vyas Puja day, he said, no, he was not interested to perform his Vyas Puja. Rather, he will hold a Prabhupada memorial day. Evening time, some disciples will do, but mostly the whole day activities will be as a Prabhupada memorial day. Whenever Maharaj will take any class, any instructions, even in initiation time also, in our ISKCON it is a tradition that initiation time they will ask for you taking the four vows of regulative principle, isn't it? This is customary in our society. But Bhaktichari Maharaj will add another vow, fifth vow. He said that's a light to abstain from four regulative principles. But one more bhava extra, what? No matter whatever happen, don't leave ISKCON. In initiation time, you have to take that bhava too. Give that promise to me. No matter whatever happen, never ever leave ISKCON. Almost all of his disciples, he will get a promise from them. Don't leave ISKCON. Why? Now ISKCON is Prabhupada's body. ISKCON and Prabhupada is not different. He used to say, if something happened that I may go out of ISKCON, but you should not leave ISKCON. He used to go that extent. Sankarsana Nityapa was mentioning how Bhaktichari Maharaj joined quite late in early 76. He was from a very aristocratic family. At that time, India and Bangladesh was one. In 1945, he appeared in Bangladesh. Then he, because he was a very wealthy family, so they had a house in Calcutta. So he came to Calcutta and in his childhood education and everything was happened in Calcutta only. Then for higher education, after school education, for college education, he went to German for higher studies to do his graduation in chemistry. Prabhupada was a chemist. And he went to do his graduation in chemistry in German, in Hamburg city. At that time, just remember, in 50s, 60s, going to German from India, for us at least I am thinking, we have not seen aeroplane. We have not seen, we heard that some Udaja, something like that. That was the time. and he went to German. But he was, I told you, no, from his previous, many previous births, he was connected spiritually and connected with Prabhupada. So he was not interested in this material education. So he came back searching spiritual life. He came all the way to Delhi, went to Rishikesh and went to Himalaya to search for some Baba or something to spiritual life. And he went somewhere in Himalaya, here and there, and saw many Baba with Ganja and all that. So he was not satisfied. He came back, went to Calcutta. There he, I don't know exactly, maybe Santadhanna Prabhu, he met past, and he got the Nectar of Devotion book. Sarvabhauma Prabhu. Sarvabhauma in Calcutta or Germany? Yes, somebody said Satadhanna, somebody said Sarvabhauma. Anyway, so he got that book and then he went to Calcutta. And somehow or other he was so curious to meet Srila Prabhupada. And then he heard that Prabhupada is coming to Kumbh Mela. Kumbh Mela happened in Allahabad in January. So he came to meet in January in Kumbh Mela. This was quite new. At that time his name was Khirchura Gopinath.
Kishore.
Really? His first incision name is Khirchura Gopinath. Then third incision is Bhakti Charu Swami. Yeah. Acha. Oh, that's how say how. Kishore Kumar, yes. Kishore Das. So and as Prabhuji was saying in Kumbh Mela, he could not get that opportunity to meet Prabhupada. But when Prabhupada was coming back to Calcutta in a train, he got the opportunity and that's it. Then Prabhupada never left him till last end. Today Govinda Maharaj was telling that he saw Bhakti Charu Swami first time. He knows him before, but he saw when Prabhupada come back from Rishikesh. Because they went, Bhakti Charu Maharaj went with them, Tamal Krishna Maharaj, Subhendra Prabhu, they went to Rishikesh for his health reason. But one time because of storm, Prabhupada felt very weak. And midnight, he woke up, Bhakti Charu Swami said, "Call everybody. Now time has come to leave my body, so take me to Vrindavan. I want to go to Vrindavan." Or some or other, they make arrangement overnight and they come back. And he was taking treatment with Banwali Kamiraj and Prabhupada get cured and he was a bit okay. And then he again desired to go to West for preaching. Though everybody was saying no, but Prabhupada, nobody can say no to Prabhupada. So Prabhupada went, and Prabhupada was very much wanted that Bhakti Charu Swami should travel with him. But at that time some happened to his passports thing, I don't know, but he went to German before, he must have passport, but he didn't get visa or something happened, he could not travel with him. So Prabhupada went and almost night 2 a.m. in morning. And next day Govinda Maharaj was saying he came to Prabhupada's house and he was thinking, now Prabhupada is not there, his kitchen is okay, no cooking, I want to clean the Prabhupada kitchen. So to clean Prabhupada kitchen, Bibi Govinda Swami wants to clean. So he went to kitchen, Prabhupada kitchen. So he saw there Bhaktisaru Swami sitting there in the kitchen and crying, profusely crying. Then at that time Govinda Maharaj was Ajodhyapati Prabhu. He asked him, "Swamiji, what happened? Why are you crying?" So he said, "I'm crying because I'm not that fortunate enough to serve Prabhupada. I could not travel with him due to some reason." So he was telling that he can make out that Bhaktisaru Swami was so much eager to serve Prabhupada that he was feeling so unhappy. He was crying profusely. So he was saying, "So this is a sign of how seriously he wants to serve Prabhupada." And he was mentioning that in our scripture, Rupa Goswami and Bhakti Rasama Sindhu mentioned, spiritual life begins with Guru Pada Asraya. Adav Guru Pada Asraya. Then Sikha, Sadharma Pricha, Visrambena Guru Seva. These are the process. Then how Bhaktisaru Maharaj was a living example of it. He met Prabhupada Radharama. Within 10 days he got first and second initiation. And within 90 days he got his third initiation. Sannyasika. And then Prabhupada gave him all books he was translating. And he was so much eager to serve Prabhupada, so much so that he wants to submit his whole life, his whole energy, everything for serving Prabhupada. That was his mood. By seeing that Prabhupada was so happy, so even this time before going to America, he was in Ujjain in the lockdown period, and he was giving almost every day classes, sometimes in Bengali, sometimes English, online classes and all that. I don't know what makes him think that he wants to go to America. I don't know. Some reason must be there. I heard one time he was speaking before going to America that Prabhupada never encouraged us to go to Vrindavan, stay Vrindavan, stay Varsana, stay this, that. No. Our preaching movement, we are all preachers. Though I know some problem is there in America, some coronavirus is going on, but as a leader, how can I stay back here? They are fighting, I will be here. He was telling like that, knowingly that America, this virus is spreading like anything and is very dangerous. Lockdown period is going on, still fearlessly he took the decision to go America. And even at that time flight was, America was not easy to get. He went all the way, Nasik, Mumbai, Nagpur, somehow he got and went to America. 16 hours flight. And there also he gave one class. And I heard that he got infected in plane only. Or somebody says in Mumbai or Nagpur, at that time there, everywhere is infection going on. Somebody said he infected in plane only, and he got high fever and throat infection when he arrived there. And you must have heard that last lecture in 6th of June in Florida. He was speaking to some students, congregation I think. and for more than 1 hour lecture. That was his, I think, last lecture. And he was explaining the final pastimes of Prabhupada, how he was there with Prabhupada. He started how he met, he went to Mumbai, and from Mumbai how Prabhupada came to Rishikesh, he was with them, and what happened, how Rishikesh come back, all this till the end of Prabhupada's samadhi, he was explaining. And the whole pastime in the lecture he was telling. It seems that he was knowingly, he almost getting ready, I want to go. That's again and again he was describing this. Now question comes, why Prabhupada, he only told that Prabhupada said, now time has come to leave my body, take me to Vrindavan. And he was a staunch follower of Prabhupada's teaching too. So he would have come to Vrindavan. Why he went to US? If this time is leave body, then better to come to Vrindavan. Prabhupada personally did that, and he told him also. He first told to Bhaktisvara Swami, said, please take me to Vrindavan. I want to leave my body in Vrindavan. And he is a staunch follower of Prabhupada. And why he is thinking to go to America? Today, Bhumipati Prabhu, he was telling that Prabhupada used to say in Bengali that India is my motherland, but America is my fatherland. And how come you are saying fatherland? Well, father is giving resource, money, because all my ISKCON is generated from America, all the funds, everything I got from America only. Man and money is from America. Otherwise, the ISKCON has no value. Everything I got from there, man from America, money from America. I told them distribute books, they distribute double it, more, more. Whatever I told, they do, and they give all support for my society. So everything I got from America. So that's my father's land. Bhumipati Prabhu was telling in Prabhupada's final pastime, he used to talk to some of Bengali, his god brothers, in Bengali language, he used to tell them that how he got all success from America, all support from America, that's why America is my father's land. And Bhaktisvara Maharaj was present there. And he knew that America is so dear to Prabhupada, this is his fatherland. And he was so humble that Prabhupada is an elevated personality, he could leave his body in Vrindavan. But who am I? I am not of that level. So I can, as a man of ISKCON, ISKCON is Prabhupada's creation. So ISKCON generated from US, America. And that's why Prabhupada considered America as his father's land. So better I should go there. And he went there. We are thinking anyway, in each scripture it is said that Krishna will fulfill the desire of a pure devotee, a surrendered devotee. So, and all devotees, they know that Prabhupada used to say always, bhajan karo, sadhan karo, morte janle hoy. If you don't know how to die, the art of dying, then all your so-called study, practice, bhajan is useless. It's good for nothing. This is final exam. Final exam is death. If you can't make it, then that's it. What the use of so much coaching and preparation if final exam is useless? So ante narayana smriti, what is the success of final exam? If you can remember Lord. Remembrance of Lord That's it. Antakale chamameva smaran muktva kalevaram. When you are living your body, muktva kalevaram, smaran. If somebody can do Krishna smaran, Krishna smriti, ante narayana smriti, that is the success of human life. That is the success of human life. All Santa, Mahanta, scripture, everybody they used to say that. That's it. No matter whatever you do in your whole lifetime, if somehow or other at the final time, death time, if you remember Lord, then that's it. That's it. So, in the case of our Bhakti Charu Swami Maharaj, it is quite natural for everybody. Even a topmost Nastic, non-believer of God, if a drastic situation is coming, just like a death situation in front, then he will definitely, forcibly remember Lord, isn't it? So Maharaj was proved positive COVID. They took him to hospital and still he was not ready to accept ventilator, though he was feeling problem in breathing. So then devotee talked, the Maharaj is not agreeing to go through ventilator. And they talked to all big, big ISKCON leaders, his godbrothers, senior godbrothers, Sesapuram, many others, they called him, Maharaj, please accept ventilator. So then all so many senior devotees, so then Maharaj agreed, okay. Why he was not accepting ventilator? Ventilator means it is not easy thing. They'll put the pipe through your nose inside. Very irritating, very uncomfortable. And for that they will make your body unconscious. So that you should not feel that heavy pain. So Maharaj didn't want to do that, but somehow that, and when it was decided that he has to go through the ventilator, they have to put the pipe inside and they will torture his body. Just imagine, any of us, anybody, any layman, he will pray to Krishna intensely, as intense as possible. Because who knows what will happen? He can't say anything. And he is going practically for that situation. That means you just imagine, if any of us will tell us that now, within 1 hour, you are going through, they will put this, that ventilator process. If somebody will explain us, then our Narayana Smriti will happen. Yes. Parikshit Maharaj got death notice a week before. And he prepared, you know, whole Bhagavatam things, all that happened. Went to. So, similar case, when going through ventilator means it is not that easy. So, mentally when he was preparing, he must drop. It is natural for everybody, as intense as possible, he will remember Lord and pray to Lord. Then he went through the ventilator when he almost remained unconscious for a week together, for at least 10 days or 15 days or so. In the last 10-15 days, whatever he was praying, in the whole world, whatever number of devotees, everybody was praying intensely. So many Narasimha Jagya, this Jagya, that Jagya, Puja, whatever, all the devotees for that 2 weeks, isn't it? 10-15 days, everybody was praying for Maharaj. So he was not praying to Krishna. He force all the devotees in ISKCON society to pray to Krishna. So it is not only one smarana of Krishna. Lakhs and lakhs of devotees, whatever possible way, they pray to Krishna. And finally, he chose, actually in America that day was 5th or 4th? 4th. But somebody said that's Guru Purnima day. There Guru Purnima is 4th, okay. So the Guru Purnima day, Sanatana Goswami's disappearance day, Sanatana Goswami's deity is Madan Mohan. And he established his deity in Ujjain in his project in Madan Mohan also. And that was the day of Sanatana Goswami, that Purnima day. So he chose that day. So actually Sanatana Goswami, because of that we are not telling Guru Purnima. Sanatana Goswami case is Mudiya Purnima. The Guru Purnima is because that is the appearance of Vyasadev. Disappearance of Sanatana Goswami, but appearance of Vyasadev. Vyasadev, all the gurus are representative of Vyasadev. That's why it's called Vyasa Purnima or Guru Purnima. Except ISKCON and Gaudiya Math, rest all organizations, spiritual organizations at least, everybody, they observe Guru Puja in that particular day. All their respective gurus and acharyas, they will worship. Even it is mentioned in Chaitanya Bhagavat that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he performed Nityananda Prabhu Vyasa Puja, Vyasa Purnima day. He was observing Vyasa Puja, Vyasa Purnima day. And so that Vyasa Purnima, Guru Purnima day and Sanatana Goswami's day, so he took the blessings of his worshipable deity Madan Mohan, Sanatana Goswami's deity Madan Mohan and Sanatana Goswami's blessings, Vyasadeva's blessings. Blessings because Guru Purnima means all the spirituals, all the gurus, they used to bless their disciples that day. That special blessings day. He took all their blessings to be at the lotus feet of his eternal guru, Srila Prabhupada. That was his only desire, to attain Prabhupada's lotus feet and serve him eternally. And in Guru Purnima day, in ISKCON, we used to speak about Sanatana Goswami because of Sanatana Goswami's disappearance day. All classes, everything about Sanatana Goswami. Nobody will discuss Vyasadev, mostly Sanatana Goswami, Mudiya Purnima and all that. But from this Guru Purnima onwards, Maharaj forced everybody in ISKCON, they have to discuss about him as a guru. We have to now remember him in that day. So now Maharaj, why everybody is touched by Maharaj? Each and every, not only devotee, those who are outsider also, any person come in contact with Maharaj somehow or other, once or twice or for some hours, for one day, Maharaj was mesmerizing personality. Everybody will get attracted by his personality. His very, very sweet behavior, his dealings, his talkings are so sweet. His singings was nectarian, so melodious. And dealings, his cookings, everything is sweet, so caring. so compassion, full of compassion, so personal. That's why he touched everybody through his dealings and personality. He was not only a good person with caring personality, he was a wonderful leader, a neta. His leadership, though he was the junior most Prabhupada disciple, but he was so lovable among everybody, so appreciated by everybody, that he became GBC chairman, the topmost authority of ISKCON. He became twice he became GBC chairman. It is not ordinary responsibility, such a high responsibility. Already he was GBC and guru and many other leading responsibility. On the top of that, he used to handle GBC chairman for 2 times. And he attracted people from very simple village of Bangladesh to British Council. From smallest to the toughest. And because he was a wonderful leader, through his instructions, through his capability, ability, he sorted out many problems. Once he also started a program to go to all old Prabhupada disciples to bring them back. That was his plan. Those who are left out, somehow or other frustrated, pride, he said, no, they should come back. He was so friendly, and he used to go to them, and by his sweet dealings, they will come back. Many of them, they come back. And anybody will deal with him for some time, he will definitely get touched. Today, one devotee was telling that once in Ujjain, the commissioner, high commissioner from MP, he was coming, and around 8 in the district, DM, district magistrate, 8 district magistrates were accompanied with that commissioner, and few SP, SSP, the high government officer with all his staffs and all his staffs was coming. And in Ujjain at that time, Maharaj Vyas Puja, just 2 days after, many international devotees, they came and they were leaving. So Maharaj was sitting, so everybody was coming and paying their obeisances and going, leaving to their country. And this high personality government officer, commissioner, so he had darshan. He was not offering obeisances to Prabhupada, not to DT. He was adamant, you know, very high officer. So finally, they brought him to Maharaj's room. And he went also, high respected officer, he went, Maharaj, sit down. But because all the devotees are leaving, so they were just coming and offering obeisances and going. They're coming, and that commissioner and 8 district magistrates were sir sitting outside. And how can he tolerate that in front of him, a Babaji, everybody is coming and paying dandavat pranam? He has not seen his lifetime. That kind of, you are saying dandavatik, what they are doing? Totally slipping down and like that. He was thinking, what is going on? Offering obeisances, respect, not considering me anything. He was sitting next to Maharaj. Nobody is talking to him, sing to him. Everybody is offering obeisances to Maharaj and going. For half an hour, he became untold. Then Maharaj told his servants, stop everybody to come. So they said, just close the door. And Maharaj talked to him for half an hour. After half an hour, when he was taking leave, he paid full prostrated obeisance to Maharaj. He didn't pay to deity in temple. Now, after half an hour, he paid his full obeisances, and all the gunmen and the SPs and the DMs, they also pay obeisances to Maharaj. That was Maharaj's power. That was his attraction. It touched their heart. So, that's why he, thousands and thousands of followers Maharaj had. Just by one smile, just by one sentence of word, a few words, he will win the heart of a person. It was so sweet, so enchanting. So, it's very, very rare to find such person. But the best among all qualities in Maharaj, the best of the best qualities, that his high regard and total surrender and dedication to the feet of his beloved spiritual master. This is revealed in the scripture, in the all revealed scripture. Jasya deva parabhakti jatha deva tatha guru. If somebody has unflinching faith at the feet of Krishna and the similar faith at the feet of Guru, then all the purport of Vedic knowledge will manifest in the chant. And here Maharaj was a living example of that kind of person. He was so much dedicated for Prabhupada. In every talking, every class, every discussion, every katha, and always, anytime, he will bring Prabhupada. Prabhupada, Prabhupada, Prabhupada is his everything. Just Prabhupada conscious, so much so Prabhupada conscious, so much. So, there are two kinds of Bhagavat. One Bhagavat is a bhakti rasa shastra. Another Bhagavat is a bhakti rasa patra. So, he is kind of bhakti rasa patra. Though he went to his desired planet where Prabhupada is there to serve him, but still for us is a great loss. When Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked Ramananda Rai, Dukha Madhye Kona Dukha Gani Guru Tara, that is the highest distress. Ramananda Rai told, Krishna Bhakta Virha Vina Nahi Dukhara. When we miss the association of such exalted devotee, then no more distress can compare to that. So in both the case, such a caliber of preacher and devotee like Maharaj is staying in the planet, is that glorious, is going also that glorious. So for him it is same, whatever he is busy in his job. But for us, we lost a jewel. So with this kind of our offerings from our feelings, from our heart, I want to offer respect, pranam and sandhanjali from my core of my heart at the lotus feet of Sri Srimad Bhakti Charu Swami Maharaj, that if he could have with out of his mercy, out of his compassion, give it just a minute drop of dedication what he has for his spiritual master, then our life will be success. Sri Bhaktacharya Swami Maharaj ki samveta bhakta vrinda ki jai.
So I was hearing today that when Prabhupada was very much ill and Bhaktacharya Maharaj was the secretary, and he used to read out the letters from his disciples, and they used to say to Prabhupada, "Prabhupada, we are praying to the Lord that old age and disease should come to us, and you should become young and preach Krishna consciousness and stay with us." So that kind of letter was coming regularly, and Bhaktacharya Maharaj used to read that out to Prabhupada. It means that they are ready to die for Prabhupada. That was the dedication of his disciples. And once Bhaktacharya Maharaj was telling that some disciples are ready, whatever Prabhupada will say, if the Prabhupada says jump from the roof, they will jump. That kind of dedication they had. But Prabhupada was not accepting that proposal, and they said, "I'll be happy that if you cooperate with each other after I leave." So Bhaktacharya Maharaj used to think they want to die for him, but he expects cooperation after his departure. So he was not realizing the importance of this statement of Prabhupada. Then when after Prabhupada left, you know that many of his followers left ISKCON. Then Bhaktacharya Maharaj realized that in Kali Yuga, giving life is easier than to stay together and push on the movement. That's why Prabhupada said, "I don't need your life. I want you to cooperate and stay together. That is more important." So it's a very interesting point I heard today. And Maharaj had a style. He was so humble. Prabhupada used to say, I heard from some of his godbrother, whenever he was a servant and used to cook and come regularly to his room, no? Generally, when he come to a spiritual master, he should offer obeisances and chant his pranam mantra, which is audible to the spiritual master. That is the etiquette. But when someone serves regularly, every time you don't do that. You should do whenever you see your guru. But a servant always sees guru. So generally they don't do. But Bhaktacharya Maharaj, whenever he will enter into his room, he will offer dandavas and chant pranam mantra of Prabhupada loudly. And Prabhupada said, "You don't need to do all the time." So he was so particular about offering his respect to his guru. So he's very, very cultured, and he's the embodiment of Vaishnava etiquette. So we'll hear from now Srivas Prabhu.
Actually, as Sankarshan Nirtai Prabhu said, this occasion of observing the Triubhav of Bhaktacharya Maharaj is a blissful and bitter experience, because on one side we are happy that Maharaj has returned to the spiritual world. That is the ultimate goal of this Krishna consciousness, to go back to Krishna. That is what we are here for. So therefore, if somebody is able to go back home, back to Godhead, we should celebrate. And in fact, it is said that the demigods, they celebrate when a living entity leaves this material world and goes back home. The demigods, they celebrate. And in fact, in the fourth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, it is mentioned when Dhruva Maharaj was on his way home, there was a big celebration. So on this side, we are to celebrate the departure of such an exalted Vaishnava. But on the other side, there is pain because we are going to miss his association. We are going to miss his wonderful activities. We are going to miss that wonderful opportunity to serve him. I got close to Bhakti Charu Maharaj in 2004. Bhakti Jita Maharaj and Bhakti Charu Maharaj were very close friends. In 2004, that is the Panchatattva installation in Mayapur, I happened to be there. And Bhakti Tirtha Maharaj was staying with Bhakti Charu Maharaj in his quarters. And I learned every year when Bhakti Tirtha Maharaj comes to Mayapur, he doesn't stay anywhere. He always stayed with Bhakti Charu Maharaj. So obviously, I had to go to that place every now and then to render some service to my spiritual master. And so the first time I went there, both of the Maharajis were there. And so as soon as I entered and I paid my obeisances, then Bhakti Jita Maharaj introduced me to Bhakti Charu Maharaj. And from that moment, he knew my name, he knew my service, he knew my relationship with Bhakti Jita Maharaj, and anywhere he would see me, he would mention my name. Anywhere. He said, Srinivas Prabhu, how are you? Srinivas, how are you doing? Like that. So, in 2016, when Ujjain for the Kumbh Mela, and I was there with 35 devotees from West Africa. That was the only time we had so many devotees from West Africa coming to India and going to Kumbh Mela. So, Bhakti Charu Maharaj was there in the Kumbh Mela. And one morning he was giving Srimad Bhagavatam class. He was to give the class. And I was sitting in the front with the devotees when he came in. We paid obeisances. And immediately he started glorifying Bhakti Jita Maharaj when he saw so many black body devotees in the assembly. He started glorifying Bhakti Jita Maharaj. That just see, all these wonderful flowers we have here are the result of the preaching of Bhakti Jita Maharaj. And then after he spoke about Bhakti Jita Maharaj, then he also started talking about my humble self. And then 2 days or 3 days later, there was a very big thunderstorm and many of the tents were knocked down, were destroyed. Our tent was still intact, but it was flooded with water. And so it was a big, big inconvenience. So when Bhakti Charu Maharaj heard that the West African devotee's tent was flooded, he immediately sent a message to us that why don't we come to the temple? He would arrange accommodation for us at the temple. And then he sent a temple bus to come. So we gathered all our things, we jumped into the bus, and we went to the Ujjain temple. And Maharaj was so kind. He makes such wonderful arrangements to receive us. And then one day he said, Bhakti Tirtha Maharaj is my very good friend and god brother. And all of you are coming from West Africa just because of his preaching. It will be my pleasure to serve you prasadam. Anything I can do for you that will please Bhakti Tirtha Maharaj, I want to do it. So he said, today, I want to feed all of you with prasadam. So, 1 o'clock, all the devotees were in Bhakti Charu Maharaj's ashram, his quarters, and there was a huge feast. And he made all of us sit around some oval table. And Maharaj personally began to serve the devotees. It was very heart-touching to see Maharaj himself serving the devotees of West Africa. In fact, that occasion left an indelible mark in the hearts of the devotees in West Africa. They have never forget, and they will never forget that occasion when Maharaj personally invited us to his quarters and served every one of us with prasadam, very sumptuous prasadam. Then in 2017, one of the devotees from West Africa, Parameshwara Prabhu, Sankarsana Nithai Prabhu, would remember, this devotee had a heart problem. And he had to undergo a surgical operation in Kolkata, and money was needed. So I had to approach a number of Srila Prabhupada disciples who were friends to Bhakti Tirtha Maharaj to request them to support this operation of this devotee. And as soon as I prayed Bhakti Charu Maharaj, actually I wrote him a letter, because he wasn't in Mayapur at that time. So I wrote him a letter that this is a situation we were in and we needed some support. Then he replied and said he will send somebody to me with some money. So I was in the temple room one morning when one of the disciples approached me and said, Prabhu, are you Srivas Das? Prabhu, I said, yes. He said, Guru Maharaj said we should give you this money. And so he was the first person who made contribution towards the surgery of Parameshwara Prabhu. So from these instances, we can see how much love Bhakti Charu Maharaj has for the devotees. He was an emblem of Vaishnav love. He was a perfect gentleman. In fact, even before I got close to him, there were lectures on Vaishnav Sadachar spoken by Bhakti Charu Maharaj. And I used to listen to those lectures regularly. And then there are also some songs that he sang. I always listen to those songs regularly. And you can see how much love he puts. So it is actually a great loss to the entire ISKCON, not only for his disciples. Definitely, the disciples will feel more pain because they will miss
his physical association. But the whole is come. The whole is come. He's going to
the wonderful activities of Bhakti Charu Maharaj. When I used to be in Mayapur, I was always looking forward to the day Maharaj would arrive in Mayapur. When Bhakti Charu Maharaj arrives in Mayapur, you will know he's around by his kirtans. He will lead the Mangarati kirtan, he will lead the Narasingha Deva kirtan, he will lead the Tulsi Puja kirtan. That is his style. And he will enthuse everybody with his very, very sweet kirtans. One time we invited him to speak on Bhaktitita Maharaj's Vyasa Puja. And he revealed to us why he became a friend to Bhaktitita Maharaj. He said, in 1977, when he was serving Srila Prabhupada, he said he used to hear somebody chanting late hour, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, in the long building. So one day he decided to find out who is that person chanting japa at 1 o'clock at night. And to his surprise, it was Ghanashyam Das Brahmachari. That is the Brahmachari name of Bhaktitita Swami Maharaj. So he said, he approached him and said, Prabhu, why are you not sleeping? Why are you chanting at this hour, 1 a.m. in the morning? And Bhaktitita Maharaj told him that, see, I have taken birth in a Western military culture, and I have to work very hard to get the mercy. You have taken birth in India. You've taken birth in West Bengal, in Mahaprabhu's tribe, so to speak. And so even if you don't chant, you go back to Godhead. But for me, I've come from a militia culture, and therefore I need to work very hard. I need to get the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and therefore I must rise up early in the morning to chant the Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. And so I said, please, do not worry about me. I want to get the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So he said, from that moment, he understood that this soul is a very special soul. Rising up at 3,
chanting Krishna's names is a very special soul. And so he said he bonded with him very nicely. Besides, he also had his book distribution in the communist bloc, because anytime letters would come to Prabhupada, Prabhupada would request that Ghanashyam's letters be read to him first before any other letters. So he said these two things, his preaching in the West, in the communist bloc, and his rising early in the morning to chant japa, attracted him. And so that's how they bonded
as friends. So, I have always seen Bhakti Charu Maharaj as an expansion of Bhakti Chaitanya Maharaj. I've often seen him non-different from Bhakti Chaitanya Maharaj. And he has also treated me in the same way. Wherever he will meet me, he will stop and he will ask me, Srivas, how are you doing? How is your sadhana bhakti? How is this? How is that? He'll always ask. So, On the 19th of June, when I heard that Maharaj was tested COVID-19 positive, and his situation was critical, and he had to be admitted in the hospital, immediately I was devastated. I was feeling this personality who is giving me some hope, this personality I'm looking up to, this personality who is inspiring me, it looks like Krishna is calling him. And then the worst happened. In fact, that very night, I had a dream. I was telling Indra Nila Prabhu yesterday that night I had a dream, and I found myself approaching a building. Probably is the hospital, some bluish building. And as I was approaching the building, I saw a very special aircraft. Very special aircraft. I've never seen that kind of aircraft before. Very immaculately white, with some inscriptions on it. I cannot read the inscriptions. The aircraft was just floating above the building. So I was wondering, what is this aircraft doing here? It is not going, it's just stationary. So as I entered the building, I saw some few devotees there. So I was telling the devotees, what is that aircraft doing outside there? I saw some aircraft, some special aircraft outside there. What is it doing? And the devotees told me that it's for Bhakti Charu Maharaj. I said, for Bhakti Charu Maharaj? They said, yes. That is an aircraft that has come to take him back home, back to Godhead. So I was completely confused. But then there were some other things going on in some rooms. So my attention, just then Maharaj came out actually. Maharaj came out of one room. He was dressed, fully dressed in the sannyas dress. And he came out and he said, Hare Krishna, serve us. I said, Hare Krishna Maharaj, I pay my obeisances. And then my attention was drawn into some other situation. And when I turned around, Maharaj was nowhere to be found. So I asked the devotees, where is Maharaj? They said, oh, Maharaj has entered the aircraft and he was gone. And the dream ended. So when I woke up, I told my wife. I said, the dream I had, it means we are going to lose Maharaj. I told her. But we had to pray. In fact, from that day onwards, whatever japa I'm doing, whatever fasting I'm doing, prayers we're doing, we are offering that, Krishna, please don't take this great soul away. We need him. We need him. We lost Guru Govinda Maharaj. We lost Tamal Krishna Goswami Maharaj. We lost Bhakti Tita Maharaj. We lost Bhakti Swarup Damodara Maharaj. And now we are going to lose.
So that was all my prayer. But Krishna wants him. Srila Prabhupada wants him. So it is very sad that we have lost such an exalted, wonderful Vaishnava. Vaishnava has His Holiness Bhakti Charu Swami Maharaj.
When I read his 2012 Vyas Puja offering to Srila Prabhupada, 2012, 8 years ago, then you can see that actually Maharaj is in the spirit of going back home. In the last two paragraphs of his offering, he told Prabhupada that you wanted me to stay here and execute certain services for you. I have finished those services. Please allow me to come back to you. 2012. Bhakti Charu Maharaj is praying like this in the offering. So it can be understood that he's aware of his leaving. He's aware. And in fact, the lecture, the last lecture in Ujjain, and the last lecture in America, you can see that he's already in the mood. He was aware he was going. So, but it's a big pain for us in this world because such a Vaishnava is very, very rare. He was a perfect Vaishnava. Hare Krishna. Sambhakti Charu Swami Maharaj ki.
Namo Om Vishnu Padaya. Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale. Shrimate Bhakti Charu. Swaminiti Namine. Snigdha Cheta. Shupraneta. Bhagninangcha Rashaplutam Prabhupadgata Prana Naomi Bhakti Charupadam Esha Pushpanjali Samarpayami.
Vandegurasi Karanarabhinda Vittai Patriti Radhika Madhava Yoda Para Madhurya Leela Gunarupa Namna Pratikshanasva danadodupasya Vande Gurasi Karanaravinda
Pratikshanasva danadodupasya Vande Gurasi Karanaravinda
Punjayuno radikelisi Yayali Viryukti Apekshaniya
Nirgunjayuno Ratikeli Sikhe Yayali Viryukti Apekshaniya
Tatrati Daksha Dati Vallabhasha Vande Gurasi Karanaravinda Sakshadharitvena samastha shastre Uktasthathabham kataye basadhe
Sakshadharitvena samastha shastre Uktasthathabham kataye basadhe
Kintu prabharya priya eva tasya Vande Gurasi Karanaravinda
Vintu Prabhorya Priya Matasya Vande Gurasi Karanaravinda
Yasya Prasada Bhagavat Prasada Yasya Prasada Jagati kuto me
Yasya prasada Bhagavat prasada Yasya prasada Jagati kuto me
Yayam suvam tasya Yasya srisanyam Vande Gurasi Karanaravinda
Vande Gurasi
Gurasi Charanaravinda Vande Gurasi Charanaravinda
Vande Gurasi Charanaravinda Vande Gurasi Charanaravinda
Charanaravinda Vande Gurasi Charanaravinda
Vande Gurasi Charanaravinda Vande Gurasi Charanaravinda
Jaya Prabhupada Jaya Prabhupada Prabhupada Jaya Prabhupada Jaya Srila Prabhupada Jai Prabhupada Jaya Prabhupada Prabhupada Jai Prabhupada Jaya Srila Prabhupada